and why we're here. And so we're just going to present ourselves and sing Here I Am to worship, and we'd love if you stand and join us.
Step down into darkness, opened my eyes, let me see. Beauty that made this heart adore you, hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship.
Yourself, and you became obedient to death, even death on a cross. And because of that, Lord, we lift you up to the highest place today. Be lifted up in our worship, be lifted up in our hearts as we meet with you this morning. We look forward to listening to you, to hearing from you, and being sent out by you. Amen.
So, good morning and welcome to everyone worshipping here in person, and also for those who are viewing us from home. Just a reminder that we're still under our COVID safe practices, so keeping 1.5 metres apart, hand hygiene, extra cleaning of the chapel, and staying home if you have any cold or flu symptoms. And these will remain important as our state borders start to open up in the coming weeks. So quite a few announcements of things that are coming up in November. It's going to be quite a busy month. Next week, Pastor Wayne George will be leading worship for us. In many traditions today, 1st of November is All Saints Day. We're going to have our All Saints celebration on the 22nd of November, so in 3 weeks' time. And here, celebrating All Saints is when we'll be reading out the names of those who've passed before us to their heavenly homes. And there's details in the bulletin, but if you have any names to include on our roll of saints, you can email Kerry Grock. Our thoughts this week are with Esther and the other family and friends of Laurie Knust, who passed away this week. His funeral is this coming Tuesday, 3rd of November, and again, the details are in the bulletin, and you can attend either in person or online. The week after that, so Tuesday the 10th of November, there's a playgroup play date at Underwood Park at 8:30 a.m. And if you need more details, you can talk to Rachel. The 29th of November, so in 4 weeks' time, that's the first Sunday of Advent, but that's also the Sunday that we'll be celebrating our Thanksgiving service. And so we'll be making a special collection of donations for the Helping Hands van. And Steve has a little display on the entry table of the sorts of things that we're especially looking for the van. So if you're out shopping in the next month or so and you see tuna at half price or baked beans for 40% off, etc., grab some of those to bring along. During the past few months, our card makers have been very busy, so our card stand is full to overflowing. So they're available for $3 or so up the back, just as you leave the chapel. So if you'd like to pick up some of those cards, either for Christmas or for birthdays, then there's cards available there. We'll also be calling soon for volunteers to help with morning tea. So they'll need to undergo some training. There's a free 30-minute online TAFE course that needs to be completed. We hope to start about 29th of November. That'll depend on us finding enough volunteers, because we need quite a few people. We're not allowed to have any self-service. We have to give you everything individually and put in the milk, etc. You can't do that yourself, according to the COVID-safe food policy. So we'll need quite a few volunteers to help with that, to put out tables, etc. Finally, as the borders are open, Julian and his dog, I think, are both going to South Australia over the holidays. So we'll be down one camera operator. So it would be good if we could have a few more people who are trained up in using the camera for our service broadcasts over the Christmas period. So if you're interested at all, it's not particularly difficult, and we can give you training for that. So again, probably see Carl for that one if you have any interest. I think that's all my announcements, so I'll pass across to Margaret.
It's my joy to welcome you all here again this morning as well, and those of you who are here bodily, and also those of you who we gather together with every week down the lens of a camera. Our theme today is "The humble will be exalted." In today's gospel, Jesus continues to explain to his disciples what a topsy-turvy, upside-down kingdom is like. There aren't leaders, just followers. No masters, just servants. No teachers, just students. No one at the top, all are equal. That certainly doesn't sound like a workable economic and educational plan. I think we've all heard a lot of economic plans just recently. We'll look today at what such a kingdom might look like. So we join together this morning in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our opening words are from Psalm 43. Please join me in the heavy set type. O God, declare me innocent and defend my cause against the ungodly. Deliver me from lying and evil people. I will put my hope in God, and once again I will praise him, my Saviour and my God. You are my protector. Why have you abandoned me? Why must I go on suffering from the cruelty of my enemies? Why am I so sad? Why am I so troubled? I will put my hope in God, and once again I will praise him, my Saviour and my God. Send your light and your truth. May they lead me and bring me back to Zion, your sacred hill, and to your temple where you live. I will put my hope in God, and once again I will praise him, my Saviour and my God. Then I will go to your altar, O God. You are the source of my happiness. I will play my harp and sing praise to you, O God, my God. I will put my hope in God, and once again I will praise him, my Saviour and my God. Amen. Today we're going to use the ancient words from Psalm 38 as our confession. Join me as we confess together. Lord, don't correct me when you are angry. Don't punish me when you are burning with anger. My guilt has become too much for me. It is a load too heavy to carry. Lord, everything I really want is clearly known to you, and you always hear me when I sigh. I admit that I have done wrong. I am troubled by my sin. Lord, don't desert me. My God, don't be far away from me. Lord, my Saviour, come quickly to help me. And we hear God's promise from Ephesians chapter 1. Give praise to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. He has blessed us with every spiritual blessing. God freely gave us his grace because of the one he loves. We have been set free because of what Christ has done. Because he bled and died, our sins have been forgiven. We have been set free because God's grace is so rich. He poured his grace on us. Amen. And now, for all those children, young and old, we hear from Rachel.
Good morning. Good morning, friends at home. Good morning, friends here. I think we have lots of families with kids at home at the moment. I think it's kind of cold season and we're not well and we don't want to be making anyone sick. I know that's true in our house. We have one at home with a cold. So I'm going to talk mostly to the camera today, but I've got the kind of tricky task of explaining to you the reading after the next reading. So you need to be thinking ahead to the gospel reading for today, because there's a very strange word in the gospel reading for today. And the word is phylactery. Okay, so Jesus is going to talk to his disciples about the Pharisees. The Pharisees were the religious leaders of the time, and they knew everything about the first five books of the Old Testament. Everything. They knew them off by heart, for one thing, but they knew how to explain them, they knew how to define them, they knew how to follow them. All the laws, all the stuff that God gave the people of Israel, they did it really, really carefully. So what's a phylactery? Well, it goes back to, Jesus is going to say something about the fact that the Pharisees like to wear really big phylacteries. I think phylactery sounds like an unfortunate medical complaint. But what it actually is one way that the Pharisees really tried to show that they were super religious. See, there are these two Bible verses way back at the start of the Bible. Here's the first one. The Lord said to Moses, speak to the Israelites and say to them, throughout the generations to come, you are to make tassels on the corner of your garments, each with a blue cord on each tassel. You will have these tassels to look at, and so you will remember all the commands of the Lord. That's the one verse. Here's the next verse. This is from Deuteronomy. Fix these words of mine in your hearts and minds. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Teach them to your children, talking about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Now, the Pharisees took this seriously. They went, if we have to tie things on our hands, bind things on our foreheads, okay, we'll make something so we can bind God's word on our foreheads. And it looks like this. Thank you, Ron. It's a little box. Can you see there's a guy's hand there? And inside that little black box is a scroll. And on the scroll is written a whole lot of scripture. So they put that in there, and there's that little lid that goes there, right? And they'd put that, and then they'd wear them like this. Can you see the guy's wearing a little box on his head? There he is wearing his little box on his head. He's taking it really, really seriously. And the Jewish people, certain Jewish men, really do still take this quite seriously. But the Pharisees went one step further. They said, well, if we're supposed to wear tassels, and we're supposed to wear God's word on our forehead, maybe I could make a really big box up here and look super impressive. Maybe my tassels could be extra long so people would go, ooh, he's really religious. Let me show you a couple more photos. So here's a guy. See the tassels on his? He's got like a prayer shawl. He's got tassels and he's got his little phylactery on there as well. And he's reading the Bible and reading the scriptures, taking it really seriously. And here's another one. Here's a little boy who's learning. See the leather bands over on his arm? So he's bound it, just like it said in the Bible, on his arm. He's got his prayer shawl and he's got his little phylactery on his forehead. Okay, and there's one more, I think. And this gentleman, slightly larger phylactery perhaps, impressive tassels. So the Pharisees would go around going, look, I've got a really large box on my head. I've got really extra big tassels on my cloak. Can I have the best seat at this banquet? Thank you very much, because I'm super religious. Can I, you know, can people go, ooh, when they see me in the street? Because I'm super religious. Yeah, thank you. Jesus didn't like that idea very much. He said, if you exalt yourself, you'll probably end up being humbled. If you humble yourself, you'll probably end up being exalted. So he didn't say, don't listen to the Pharisees. He said, listen, you do everything the Pharisees tell you. Just don't do anything that they do, because they're not practicing what they preach. Ouch. And then he said the best part, which is for us today. Humble yourself and you'll be exalted. Exalt yourself and you'll be humbled. And that sounds like a nice rule, except that Jesus was the best example of that ever, wasn't he? He humbled himself right down to being one of us and then died for us. And then he was exalted. And that's the best part. So we have this incredible example of our Saviour who humbled himself. He didn't want all the best seats and he didn't want all the best stuff. He didn't want to show off how religious he was. He humbled himself. He's our big example. So we can follow him. Now you've got to be listening for that big word in two readings time. I know you can do it.
The epistle for today is written in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 9 to 13. Surely you remember, brothers and sisters, our toil and hardship. We worked night and day in order not to be a burden to anyone while we preached the gospel of God to you. You are witnesses, and so is God, of how holy, righteous, and blameless we were among you who believed. For you know that we dealt with each of you as a father deals with his own children, encouraging, comforting, and urging you to live lives worthy of God, who calls you into his kingdom and glory. And we also thank God continually, because when you received the word of God, which you heard from us, you accepted it, not as a human word, but as it actually is, the word of God, which is indeed at work in you who believe. And the response, come near, you nations, and listen. Pay attention, you peoples. Let the earth hear and all that is in it.
The gospel reading is from Matthew chapter 23, verses 1 to 12. Please stand for the gospel. Then Jesus said to the crowds and to his disciples, the teachers of the law and the Pharisees sit in Moses' seat, so you must be careful to do everything they tell you. But do not do what they do, for they do not practice what they preach. They tie up heavy, cumbersome loads and put them on other people's shoulders, but they themselves are not willing to lift a finger to move them. Everything they do is done for people to see. They make their phylacteries wide and the tassels on their garments long. They love the place of honour at banquets and the most important seats in the synagogues. They love to be greeted with respect in the marketplaces and to be called rabbi by others. But you are not to be called rabbi, for you have one teacher and you are all brothers. And do not call anyone on earth father, for you have one father and he is in heaven. Nor are you to be called instructors, for you have one instructor, the Messiah. The greatest among you will be your servant. For those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. Come near, you nations, and listen. Pay attention, you peoples. Let the earth hear and all that is in it.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is, what a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is, nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus.
Kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is
is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus.
The current COVID pandemic has provided us with space to think about how we live, how we work, and how we build and sustain our sense of community. Rather than this being simply a time to wait until normality returns, it's a chance to evaluate what we'd like our new normal to be like. For many businesses, the disruption of having to work from home has meant reconsidering whether we need separate workplaces, and if so, what they should look like. Forced to use technology-based online meetings, many organizations now question the need for extensive interstate and international business travel. As a congregation, we're still working out what it means to have a significant online presence. We're learning the science and also the art of providing meaningful online worship, and we still have to figure out exactly how to maintain and grow online discipling communities. Now, if the current COVID-19 pandemic is a massive social disruption in the 21st century, then Jesus of Nazareth was a much more significant social disruption in first century Israel. Today's gospel reading from Matthew 23 is part of the build-up to the drama of Jesus' death and crucifixion. Jesus arrived in Jerusalem a few days ago in a fanfare. Since then, he's mostly been in the temple courts, arguing with the religious leaders and preaching to the crowds. In the previous chapter, Jesus had been questioned by the Sadducees about the resurrection and by the Pharisees about his authority to preach. In both cases, Jesus wins the argument, and chapter 22 ends with nobody willing to ask him any more trick questions. Unable to discredit Jesus' teaching, the plots start to kill him. In our reading, Jesus starts explaining to the people what's wrong with the current religious establishment, or more accurately, how the kingdom of heaven is different to the kingdom they see on earth. Now, this past year, perhaps it's because of COVID, perhaps because I was recently retired, I've been watching a lot more movies on Netflix. And it's interesting to consider Matthew's gospel as a dramatic narrative. Jesus is the protagonist in the story, the Messiah who will restore the new kingdom, the kingdom of heaven. Now, any good dramatic protagonist needs an antagonist, somebody or something who wishes to thwart the protagonist. Both these words end with this suffix agonist from the Greek, meaning to contend for a prize. So the protagonist is the proto or first and main contender for the prize, and the anti-agonist or antagonist is the one who works against him or her. In some cases, the two characters are polar opposites, one an evil and powerful villain and the other an heroic underdog. Think James Bond and whichever villain he's currently pitted against. In other dramas, the protagonist and the antagonist are similar in their intents and goals, but with some significant difference. In the Star Wars series, Luke Skywalker and Darth Vader are both Jedi Knights. Both start off seeking to do what's right, but one succumbs to the dark side. Matthew's gospel drama sees Jesus pitted against the Pharisees and other religious leaders as his antagonists. They're not villains, rather they share much in common with Jesus. They are seemingly model citizens of Israel, accepted as religious leaders because of their zeal for the law, They're intensely loyal to the God of Israel and wish to keep the Israelites separate and unpolluted from the surrounding cultures. They are keen students of Scripture and wish to understand God. Nicodemus, who questioned Jesus in the night, was a Pharisee, and so was St. Paul. However, the Pharisees were misguided in their understanding of the law and misled by their pride in their own position as respected members of society. They liked to decide who was in and who was out. So what was wrong with their understanding of the law? In fact, what's a right understanding of the law for them and for us today? As Lutherans, we sometimes speak about law and gospel as opposites because we like simple black and white divisions, don't we? Good and evil, right and wrong, slave and free, saint and sinner. So law and gospel initially appear as opposites. The law condemns, the gospel saves. The law brings death, the gospel brings life. But to understand more about God's law, we need to go back to the Old Testament. For example, in Psalm 1, at the very beginning of the Psalms, blessed is the one whose delight is in the law of the Lord and who meditates on his law day and night. The Hebrew word translated here as law is Torah, and it's better translated as guidance, teaching, and instruction. The Torah expresses God's expectations for the moral and spiritual conduct of Israel to enable them to live life as he created it to be lived. It's much more than a set of regulations. Psalm 119 uses words like testimonies, decrees, precepts, statutes, commandments, ordinances, ways, and word to describe God's law. This law was part of the covenant with the Israelites given to Moses. Importantly, this law was given after God had already rescued the Israelites from captivity. First comes redemption, then comes God's instruction for how to live as God's redeemed people, what we call the law. The law given to Moses is not a set of rules to achieve salvation. It's instruction for how to live as God's rescued people. So from Deuteronomy 30, this day I call the heavens and earth as witnesses against you that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Now choose life so that you and your children may live and you may love the Lord your God, listen to his voice and hold fast to him. For the Lord is your life and he will give you many years in the land he swore to your fathers, Abraham, Isaac and Jacob. So in that passage, this phrase, choose life so that you might live, might seem a bit odd. But we can expand it out to choose life, that is, choose love for God and love for neighbour, so that you may live, that is, you may really live. Live life to the full, to live as a complete human being. Israel continually strayed from God's instruction. They worshipped other gods, they failed to care for each other. Especially they failed to care for the poor and the oppressed. The Old Testament prophets continually warned the Israelites to turn back to God. They kept reminding them that the only way to live a meaningful life was in serving God and neighbor. They didn't listen, and the people of Israel and Judah were eventually defeated and taken into exile. Still, God's message was that restoration and redemption is there for God's people. When the temple was rebuilt in Jerusalem, further exile was something to be avoided at all costs, and that's when sects like the Pharisees emerged. And they wanted to make sure God's people would stay faithful to God. However, they misunderstood the purpose of God's law. Instead of a guidebook for a fruitful life, it became a set of prescriptions to earn God's favor. The laws were expanded into more and more complex regulations. Purity laws designed for priests were expanded so that whole groups of people were excluded from the temple. The Pharisees promoted holiness, separateness from anybody who didn't fit their rules and regulations. Isaiah predicted this centuries before from Isaiah 28. God will speak to this people to whom he said, this is a resting place. Let the weary rest. And this is a place of repose. But they wouldn't listen. So then the word of God to them will become, do this, do that, a rule for this, a rule for that, a little here, a little there, so that as they go, they'll fall backwards. They'll be injured and snared and captured. Jesus repeats this message to the crowds in Jerusalem in very similar words. He talks about the Pharisees. They tie up heavy, cumbersome loads and put them on people's shoulders, but they themselves are not willing to lift a finger to move them. To the Pharisees, the kingdom would come when their vision of the law was observed perfectly. Remembering that St. Paul was a Pharisee, it was this corrupted version of the law that Paul was speaking against in his epistles. He explains that the version of the law the Pharisees were preaching, the version of the law that he'd understood as a Pharisee, couldn't save Israel and couldn't earn God's favor. Just as God redeemed the Israelites from slavery in Egypt and then gave them the law to teach them how to live as redeemed people, so God has redeemed the whole world from slavery to sin through Jesus Christ, and he continues to teach us how to live as redeemed disciples of Christ in the new kingdom of heaven. But what exactly is this new kingdom that Jesus teaches about over and over and over again in the Gospels? In the Old Testament, there's many images of what's called God's kingdom or the kingdom of God. Matthew calls it the kingdom of heaven to avoid using the holy name of God, but it means the same thing. Jesus' primary message in the Gospels is that he is bringing in this new kingdom, this new reign of God in our lives. And Jesus tells us that the kingdom is right here, right now, in our midst and within our grasp. Paul calls this kingdom righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. It's the new life that is inherited when we follow Jesus. Jesus describes it as a seed that's grown and yields a harvest, a treasure of great worth, a tiny seed that grows into an enormous tree, and many other images. And Jesus also tells us how to find this kingdom. Luke 17, it says, once on being asked by the Pharisees when the kingdom of God would come, Jesus replied, the coming of the kingdom of God is not something that can be observed, nor will people say, here it is, or there it is, because the kingdom of God is in your midst. So we find this new kingdom when we listen to and follow Jesus' instructions and his teaching, if you like, his law for his new covenant. Jesus says this kingdom is like a feast to which everybody is invited. And today we share this feast when we taste and see the bread and wine. We find the kingdom when we are humble, when we are meek. If we're proud and vain like the Pharisees, you can't see this kingdom. If you claim to be a respected authority, a wise teacher, a father to your flock, then you miss it. If you seek riches, respect, authority, you miss it. If you're poor in spirit, if you're mourning, or if you're persecuted, then you'll see this kingdom of peace and deliverance. You find this kingdom when you feed the hungry, when you clothe the naked, when you shelter the homeless, when you care for those rejected by society. In Jesus' time, the tax collectors and prostitutes found the kingdom. Many of the Pharisees did not. Today the message is the same as it was in God's original law given to Israel. Choose life so that you may live. That is, choose life in Jesus' new kingdom, a kingdom of humility and service, so that you may live, that is, really live as God intended, a rich and fulfilling life of love for God and love for all creation. Amen. So during our next song, we'll collect our offering and we acknowledge all those who've given electronically before or even during the service. And during this song, the ushers will come around with bags to collect your offering.
Before the world began, you were on his mind, and every tear you cry is precious in his eyes. Because of his great love, he gave his only son. Everything was done so you would come. Nothing do could make him love you more, and nothing that you've done could make him close the door. Because of his great love, he gave his only son. Everything was done so you would come to the Father. Take them all. The power of the word, the power of his blood. Everything was done so you would come. Nothing you can do could make him love you more, and nothing that you've done could make him close the door. Because of his great love, he gave his only son. Everything was done so you would come to the Father. Though your gift is small, broken hearts, broken lives, he will take them. So you would come to the Father,
to the Father.
Though your gift is small, broken hearts, broken lives, he will take them all. The power. Everything was done so you would come. The power of the word, the power of his blood. Everything was done so you would come.
We acknowledge now all those who continue to support the work of our congregation through the gifts of their time, their talents, and their possessions. Let us pray. Lord, you have given us forgiveness of sins and salvation and made us your own children. You alone are our Lord and our Father and our teacher. Teach us that true greatness in your kingdom means service to you and each other. Amen. Let's stand now and confess our faith with Christians of all times and in all places as we confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. As we begin our liturgy for communion. The Lord be with you and also with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. And let us now repeat the words of the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The bread and wine have already been consecrated prior to our service this morning. So let us all join and repeat together the words of institution as a reminder of what this meal means. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup after the supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink of it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
So I'd invite the stewards, the deacons, the band, and those leading children's ministries to come forward first to receive communion. And you can come right up to the chancel here. While they're coming forward, I'll invite you to share the peace of the Lord with a nod to those around you. We welcome to communion all who believe that they receive the body and blood of Jesus in this holy meal. So our procedure today is the same as in previous weeks. Stewards, deacons and others and the band will commune first. And then after they've communed, the stewards and deacons will put on gloves and bring the bread and wine to you in your place. They'll invite you to eat and drink as soon as you've received the bread and removed it from its bag and then the wine. Gluten-free wafers are available on request. Please ask the deacons. All the wine is without alcohol. And after distribution, the stewards will come around with bins to collect any empties. Families attending children's ministries can head out as soon as they've received communion. And so the invitation. Jesus says, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. All is ready. All are welcome."
That will stand firm.
to have this heart in me.
the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve us in body and soul to life everlasting. Go in peace. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, Heavenly Father, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. By this holy sacrament, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts so that we may more perfectly love you and worthily praise your holy name. Amen.
And all those in need. Each petition will end with, Lord, in your mercy, please respond with, hear our prayer. Join me now. God of mercy, throughout history your goodness prevails. Open the hearts of all people to find you and your mercy that endures forever. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of peace, bend that which is inflexible, the barriers that divide, and the attachments that thwart reconciliation. Bring peace in this nation and throughout the world. Restore wholeness among us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of justice, healer and redeemer, heal those who suffer from illness, poverty and exclusion. Hasten justice for those suffering under the power of evil. Give new life to all. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, rock and fortress, protect refugees and those without homes or security, children without families. Help us always to defend human dignity. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, creator, all creation groans in expectation. Convert us from greed and exploitation. Teach us to live in harmony with your creation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of mercy, strengthen and protect those who are persecuted for faith in you and those of other faiths who suffer persecution. Give us the courage to profess our faith. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of life, heal painful memories. Transform all complacency, indifference, and ignorance. Pour out a spirit of reconciliation. Turn us to you and one another. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of love, your Son Jesus reveals the mystery of love among us. Strengthen that unity that you alone sustain in our diversity. God, our sustenance, thank you for bringing us together at your Eucharist table. Nurture within and among us a communion anchored in your love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We ask all these things in your holy name, one God, now and forever. Amen.
And as we come to the end of our time of worship together, I'd like to thank everyone who makes this time of worship possible. Our musicians, our deacons, our ushers, and to all of those people who are behind the scenes that nobody ever sees. Thank you to those of you who worship with us regularly each week too. After our blessing and final song, please leave the church starting from the rear and please avoid crowding. And if you wish to catch up with people, you may do so in the hub outside or invite people home for a coffee. Please don't congregate in the foyer, but please move outside. So, the Lord bless us and keep us. The Lord make his face to shine upon us and be gracious to us. The Lord look upon us with his favour and give us his peace. Amen. Our final song, Sent Out by God's Blessing.